Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Hope inshallah everyone is doing well. Alhamdulillah, we have a special guest today, Ustad Muhammad from the UK, and who will inshallah touch on a very important topic, the importance of finding happiness in tawheed, in la ilaha illallah. But inshallah, as soon as the chef comes in, we will bring him in, inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ustaz, kayf halak?
Alhamdulillah, how are you, akhi? You okay?
Alhamdulillah, Sheikh, all is well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you.
Ameen, ameen.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wal aqibatu lil muttaqin, wa la udwana illa ala al-zalimeen, wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah, wa ahduhu la sharika la, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. Alhamdulillah, we have our special guest, Ustaz, our Sheikh, Sheikh Muhammad, from UK, who will inshallah ta'ala give us a reminder about the most important topic, and that is La ilaha illallah. And as we all know that we are always in need of reminder. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the famous verse, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And remind, for verily the reminder will benefit the believer. And subhanallah, look at the ayah that comes after this. After Allah says, remind each other, the next ayah is, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. That Allah tells us that the best thing to remind each other about is about La ilaha illallah, the purpose of our creation. And we have our guest, Sheikh Ustad Muhammad from UK, who will give us a talk on the importance of finding happiness in La ilaha illallah. And if you guys have any question, you guys can type the question, and inshallah, the Ustad will give us the last few minutes to answer those questions, inshallah.
Zakallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah, الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. وكفى بالله شهيدا. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. إقرارا به وتوحيدا. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. صلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما مزيدا. أما بعد. So alhamdulillah, like the brother mentioned, today's topic is it's a question which everybody asks, whether they are practicing or non-practicing, whether they are young or old, whether they are Muslim or non-Muslim. And that is, what can I do to attain happiness? Where can I find happiness? This is a question where all of mankind look for. And to answer this question, I have another question, which is, what is the most important thing for anybody to search for anybody to do? Or what is the most important thing in this dunya, in this world? And that, without any doubt, is the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Without any doubt, that is singling out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in everything which is exclusive to Him. And how can that not be the case? Like the brother mentioned the ayah, وَمَا خَلَقَتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that He has not created jinn or mankind except for this purpose, except for the purpose of singling Him out in worship. And that is our purpose in life. And how can one try to seek any sort of happiness except through fulfilling his purpose? When he is not fulfilling his purpose, how can he ever hope for any sort of happiness? He might find temporary happiness, without any doubt. However, that true contentment is only in fulfilling one's purpose. And we find this in even the materialistic things. When you have a device and you use it in a manner and in the way it's meant to be used, i.e. to fulfill its purpose, then you see it works perfectly and there's no problems with it. But once you start using it in a manner, in a way where it's not meant to be used. You know, in the beginning, you know, you might be able to use it in a way. Let's say you're trying to use it in an illegal way, or you're trying to download, let's say, if it's a phone too much that it can't handle, or use a software that it's not built for. You know, in the beginning, it might look all good, but eventually it has a toll and the device doesn't work anymore. The same thing in life. The only time that you can find that true happiness is in that tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And like you mentioned, the most important thing is the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how can that not be the case? Well, firstly, we mentioned that it is the purpose why we have been created. Secondly, we cannot enter Jannah except through this tawheed. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, قُولُوا لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ تُفْلِحُوا. Say, لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Say it fully, believing in it and acting in accordance with it. And what will happen? تُفْلِحُوا. You will become successful. How can you not gain happiness through tawheed when also it's a means of your sins being forgiven? Where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith Qudsi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and it's narrated in Tirmidhi, and it's hadith number 42 from 40 Nawiyah. Ya bana Adam, innaka law ataytani bi qurabi al-ardi khataya thumma laqitani la tushriku bi shay'a la ataytuka bi qurabiha maghfira. O son of Adam, if you come to me with the earth's amount of sins, but as long as you affirm this tawheed and you do not come a shirk with me, I will forgive all of your sins. All of your sins forgiven. With one condition, which is coming with tawheed and not committing shirk with Allah. How can we not find happiness in a tawheed when it is also a means of your sin, of your good deeds being increased? How can we not, and this I think is point number five, how can we not have find happiness in tawheed where this is a means of gaining the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on Yawm al Qiyamah? Where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked by Abu Huraira, and Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, من أسعد الناس بشفاعتك يوم القيامة؟ O Messenger of Allah, who will be the one who is the most happy and most deserving of your intercession on the Day of Judgment? قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من قال لا إله إلا الله خالصا من قلبه. The one who says لا إله إلا الله and affirms his tawheed of Allah سبحانه وتعالى sincerely from his heart. And how can tawheed not be the means of happiness when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly states this in the Quran in many different ways? From them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبَ. That it is not except with the remembrance of Allah, and remembrance of Allah is a means of tawheed. You're only remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're only doing these adhkar, this means this worship only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. The hearts find true peace. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another place, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. The very those who believe and they do not do ظلم, they do not do oppression, they do not commit oppression. What does the word oppression here mean? It's like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained that it means the same meaning what Luqman said to his son, "Inna shirka la zulman azim." What it means by oppression here is committing shirk, whether major or minor shirk. If people, those who believe and do not commit this oppression, do not commit this shirk, ulaika lahumul amn. They are the ones who will be granted the safety, wahum muhtadun, and they are the ones who will be guided. They will be granted the safety in everything at work. They will be granted the safety at the masjid. They will be granted the safety at times of calamities. And ultimately, they will be granted the safety when it matters the most, which is in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment. So how can one not find happiness? How can somebody try to look for happiness in other than tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The ayah says, you do not commit shirk. You do not come with shirk, whether major or minor. Why is this the case? Because once you commit shirk, well, even if it's minor, you pray just because somebody else is watching. You do any other ibadah and it falls under the minor type of shirk, automatically what you've done, you've placed that happiness in other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah will say, go try to find that happiness in other than me. And the other creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this big creation of Allah, they do not own happiness, so they cannot give it to you. And the only one that can give you that true happiness is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in a different ayah, وَلَا يُبَدِّلَنَّ لَهُم مِّن بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِشَيْءٍ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will turn all of their fears, وَلَا يُخَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا, into safeness, and this is a form of happiness. For what reason? يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِشَيْءٍ. Because they worship me alone, they affirm this tawheed, and they do not commit any shirk with me. And when you affirm this tawheed, all three types of tawheed, even in asma wa sifat, in the names and attributes of Allah, when you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that created you, when you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-raziq and He is the one that provides for you, and you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mudabbir li jami' al-umur, is the controller of all affairs, and you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears everything, and you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the whole sea and He sees everything, and you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one that gave you this ability to feel, and He is the one that gives this happiness, then you will only try to seek that happiness from Allah. And when you seek that happiness only from Allah and in the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's when you will feel that ultimate contentment. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us this happiness that it is only found in the tawheed of Himself, Jalla wa Ala.
Ustaz, one of my favorite verses, Ustaz, is وَمَنْ يُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ يَهْدِ
قَلْبَهُ. Allahu
Akbar.
Such an amazing ayah. You want to translate the ayah for the people?
Tafaddal,
Sheikh. Yeah. So, okay. You mentioned it, so you can translate it, inshallah.
وَمَنْ يُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ, whomsoever believes in Allah, i.e. has the right sound aqidah, has a strong la ilaha illallah, believes in the qada and the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَنْ يُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ يَهْدِ قَلْبَ, he will find peace and tranquility in his heart. Because if anything bad happens to him, he knows this is a test, or this is because of his sins. Something good happens to him, he knows it's a blessing of Allah. You know, so he'll be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Jameel. And this reminds me in Kitab al-Tawheed, Shaykh Muhammad al-Wahhab brings this ayah in a chapter of Sabr. I can't remember which chapter number, I think it's 36 approximately there. And straight after this ayah, he mentions a statement of Alqamah explaining this ayah. And Alqamah says, هو الرجل تصيبه المصيبة فيعلم أنها من عند الله فيرضى ويسلم. That regarding this ayah is regarding the person that a calamity befalls him. فَيَعْلَمُ أَنَّهَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. He knows that this is only from Allah. This is where the tawheed of the power of his tawheed is shown. That he knows, he's happy with the qadr of Allah. He knows that this is only from Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed for this to happen. فَيَرْضَى وَيُسَلِّمْ. So he accepts it and he becomes happy. And this is why the next point that I wanted to mention, or just before I move on to the next point, there's a saying of Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah that I just remembered. And this is a profound statement. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he says, مَنَ عَرَفَ اللَّهَ بِأَسْمَائِهِ وَصِفَاتِهِ وَأَفْعَالِهِ. That whoever knows and learns about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His names, His attributes, His actions, أَحَبَّهُ لَا مَحَالَ, he will love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there is no doubt in that. Allahu Akbar. So when you learn about the one who created you, and then you do the actions that you were created for, only then will the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala find that true happiness. And I want to move on to another point. And this point is more of a point, a bit more of a, instead of making it just theoretical and talking about tawheed, a bit more practical, inshallah. And this is mentioned in the beginning of Al-Qa'id Al-Arba' as well. The author, he mentioned some keys of happiness, ways of attaining happiness. And he originally took this from Ibn Qayyim's book, Al-Wabil As-Sayyib. And he mentions three things, but we're just going to focus on two for now. And then at the end, if there's time, I'll mention the third. And that is, a person, and especially a mu'min, he's in either two states. He's either in a state of bliss, where blessings have been given to him, or he's in a state of calamity. Or that a calamity has befallen him. And especially this one. This is the one where the tawheed is really tested. But the tawheed of a person is also tested in the first one. How? When you have been given these blessings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing you. وَنَبَلُوكُمْ بِالْخَيْرِ وَالشَّرِّ فِتْنَةً. that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, we are testing you with the, and it becomes a fitna, what, the good and the evil. Innama amwalukum awladukum fitna. Verily your children and your money, all of this is a fitna, it's a trial from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for you to have that ultimate happiness that you're looking for, even in times of goodness, times of easiness, in times of blessings and bliss, we have to affirm that tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how is the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled? And subhanAllah, you'll find, and this point is very important, that people who have been given everything, all of these blessings, you'll find that even they are the ones who are not happy in this life. Look at the footballers, look at the celebrities. Okay? They've been given everything and they have fallen into this category. But they don't have this happiness. They are the ones that end up falling into depression. And a'udhu billah, they sometimes end up committing suicide. Whereas you won't find that those who worship Allah Ta'ala and affirm that tawheed, you'll rarely ever hear of any person like that committing any sort of action. So how does one affirm the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in times of bliss? And this is by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this thanking of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you that ni'mah, and also after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows that ni'mah upon you. Before that ni'mah, before the ni'mah has even come to you, how do you affirm that tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Firstly, when you see other people having that ni'mah, let's just say it's a car that you want. You want this car. If you do not attribute this blessing that this person has got to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you are not affirmed this tawheed. You have to affirm all of these blessings back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firstly. And then, when you also want these blessings, you only ask it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what a lot of us do is that we run to this person and here and there, trying to attain that blessing, but we don't go to the one who grants these blessings in the first place. Just as we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us Jannah, because He owns it, we should also ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for these provisions, because He is the one that also owns them. So before the blessing even comes to us, this is how we thank Allah. We attribute these blessings only to Allah, and then we ask only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us these. And then without any doubt, we take the means, we take the asbab without any doubt. But the reason I'm focusing more on this is because this is the point where a lot of people forget. They'll go out and they'll work, but then they won't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then there are those who are the opposite, that they will just ask Allah, but then they won't actually do any of the actions. And this goes against the tawakkul, the reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is before the blessing. As for after the blessing, then we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with three components, with three things. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our hearts. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our tongues. And we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our limbs. With our hearts, again, we attribute it only back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, sometimes, and this is the famous hadith of Thalathat min Bani Israel, the three people from Bani Israel, the person who was blind, the one who had leper, and the one who was the third one, bald. And then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted them what they wanted, and Allah gave more, two of them said, now, what I've gained, now the blessings that Allah has given me, they, when a person came asking for help, they said, no, this is from me, you know, this is something that I've earned. And they didn't attribute it back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas the third, the one who was blind, he attributed it back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the angel at the end of the hadith said, فَقَدْ رَضِيَ عَنْكَ وَسُخِطَ عَلَى صَاحِبَيْكَ. That Allah ta'ala has become pleased with you and has become angry with your two companions who did not attribute that blessing back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we believe that it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firstly. And then it is also from your hard work, but that is only from the tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's with the heart. And then with the tongue, is that you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you talk about these ni'am, you talk about these blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Duha, وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. And as for the blessings of your Lord, then talk about them, speak about them. Let the people know that this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And finally, with the limbs. With the limbs, by using those blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you in a manner which is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not in a manner which displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by doing this with that blessing, you are affirming that tawheed and doing what is obligatory upon you with that blessing. And This is a means. وَإِنْ تَأَذَّنَا رَبُّكُمْ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. This is a means for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, if you are thankful, I will increase you. He will increase you more blessings, and he will increase you in happiness. And then, so this is the first state of a Muslim, that he's been given all these blessings and he's in bliss. The second, and this, like we said, this is the one where a lot of people trip up. And this is when calamity befalls them. When calamity befalls them. And when a calamity befalls a person, there are four types of people. There are four types of people. The first is a person who is complaining and despondent. The second is a person who is just patient. The third is a person who is pleased. And the fourth is a person who is thankful, pleased and thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first, the one who is complaining and being despondent. And what I mean by complaining is not, you know, if you something happens to you, you go to your family, you complain and you try to talk it out and you try to look for solutions. La, la. When we mean complaining, we mean when people turn around and say things like, why is Allah doing this to me? Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being oppressive to me? Things like this. Okay? One of the brothers asking, he's got a question. We've got a question, type it out, inshallah. Yes.
Brother, this, if you have a question, you can type, inshallah, we'll ask the Shaykh at the end.
So this type of being despondent and complaining, what's the ruling on this? This is a major sin. And I say, it's not just a normal sin. This is a major sin. Why? Because this shows that you are not pleased and happy and content with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is a pillar of Iman. And as you know, Iman, this is from At-Tawheed. It shows that you are, so this shows that you have a deficiency in your Tawheed. So this is the lowest, those who are complaining and despondent. Then we have a level higher than that, which is patience. Which is patience. And the ruling of patience, like Imam Ahmad said, he said, وَرَدَ الصَّبْرُ فِي الْقُرْآنِ فِي نَحْوِ 90 مَوْضِعَ. He says that the patience has been mentioned in the Quran approximately 90 times. وَهُوَ وَاجِبٌ بِإِجْمَاعِ الْأُمَّةِ. And it is obligatory by the consensus of the scholars, or the consensus of the ummah, of this nation. It is obligatory. And what does obligatory mean? With the most famous definition that people give, if you do it, you're rewarded. But if you don't do it, then you are deserving of punishment. So it's something obligatory. Because if you do not come with this patience, then this shows that you have a deficiency in your tawheed, in believing in the divine decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he carries on, Imam Ahmad, and we'll come back to his statement. The third level is being pleased. Being pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the position that he has put you in. And the fourth, the highest, is not only being pleased, but you also thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why Imam Ahmad, to complete his statement, he said, after mentioning this, وَهُوَ وَاجِبٌ بِإِجْمَاعِ الْأُمَّةِ, he says, فَإِنَّهُ نِصْفُ الْإِيمَانِ, because being patient is half of faith. فَإِنَّ الْإِيمَانَ نِصْفَانِ, because faith, or having iman, is two halves. نِصْفٌ صَبَرْ وَنِصْفٌ شُكْرٌ. The first half is having patience, and the second half is being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is mentioned by Ibn Qayyim in Madarij al-Sali. So this, all of this shows that a person is either in two states. He's either in the state of gratitude, or he is in the state of a calamity. And all of this is testing your tawheed. Depending on how strong your tawheed is and how well you affirm that tawheed, that's how your happiness will be. And We have some time, alhamdulillah. The third thing that the author mentioned in Qad al-Arba', which is also that if you commit sins, that you go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you ask for forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is also a means of gaining the happiness that you are looking for. So these three things that the author mentions, another way of looking at it is, one may ask that, why did the author mention these three things in the beginning of his book, Al-Qa'id al-Arba'? The book, as you know, Qad al-Arba' is talking about shirk, which is, well, if you stay away from shirk, that is a mean, that is a way of affirming that tawheed. All of these three, we've already talked about how it's connected to tawheed, but there's also another way of how it's connected to tawheed. Because doing shukr for your blessings. What is the greatest blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you? The greatest blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you without any doubt is the blessing of Tawheed. It's the blessing of Tawheed. How many people have been given so many things, but they've not been given Tawheed? And that will not benefit them in this dunya or in the akhirah. But with Tawheed, it benefits you in this dunya. From the ways it benefits you in this dunya is this happiness that we are talking about. And it and also in the akhirah. This Tawheed will make you happy in the akhirah also when you are standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then also having patience. And we talked about how patience is connected to Tawheed because it's connected to being happy with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also al-istighfar. From the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the names attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a type of Tawheed. Al-Ghafoor, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is the most forgiving. So, by us not going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking Him for forgiveness, we are not affirming this name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are not using the athar of this name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What would be the means, what would be the point of this name if Allah is not going to forgive? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all forgiving. So much so that in a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that if we were to not ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, He would create a creation just so that they can sin, just so that they can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-ghafoor. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all forgiving. So all of these points all come back to At-Tawheed. And this is why At-Tawheed, this is the right, it's the haqq of Allah, it's the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the first obligation for us. وَأَوَّلُ وَاجِبٌ عَلَى الْعَبِيدِ مَعْرِفَةُ الرَّحْمَنِ بِالتَّوْحِيدِ. That the first obligation upon the slaves is knowing the most merciful with his Tawheed. And like you mentioned, it is fulfilling our purpose in life. It is a means of entering into Jannah. It is a means of our sins being forgiven. It is a means for our good deeds being increased. It is a means for us gaining security and guidance in this dunya. It is a means of gaining the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And these are just some of the benefits of Tawheed. And only through the Tawheed will we be able to gain the answer that we are looking for, which is how does one attain happiness? And the answer is, like we've just mentioned throughout the whole of this reminder, it is the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I think we'll stop here unless the brother wants to add anything.
Also the conditions of patience as well. You know, for the scholars, they mentioned that if someone wants to have patience, as God mentioned, is the act of worship, and every act of worship comes with conditions. And the scholars, they mentioned three conditions for sabr. One, that when you're patient, you have to do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. That you have patience, you are holding yourself back for the sake of seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also, when you are patient, also this should happen on the spot whenever the test happens. That, as the Prophet ﷺ told the lady, that in the masab, that patient is when the incident takes place on the spot. There's no point of being patient after 6 months or 4 weeks of the incident taking place. And the third condition is that while you're patient, you shouldn't keep talking about this and complaining with your mouth. As Ya'qub alayhi salam, إِنَّمَا أَشْكُوا بَثِّي وَحُزْنِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. So those are the three conditions also if you want to perfect that sabr, that you do it for Allah, you do it when the calamity happens, and you do it without complaining to the people. And one beautiful verse inside Surah Anfal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, and Allah is talking to us, the believers, istajibu lillahi, respond back to Allah. You know, reply back to Allah, istajibu lillahi walil rasul, and the messenger. Respond back to Allah when يا أيها الذين آمنوا استجيبوا لله وللرسول إذا دعيكم لما يحييكم. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling you to that which will give you life. And what is that? Allah is calling you to la ilaha illallah, to worship Allah alone. And the Prophet is calling you to what? قولوا لا إله إلا الله. For doing la ilaha illallah will give you life. Why? Because you are fulfilling the purpose of your creation. Fajazakallah khair, Ustadhuna al-Fadil. Beautiful reminder, very beneficial. And if anyone has any question about the topic or outside the topic, inshallah, the Sheikh has a few minutes with us. What was the third condition for sabr? The third condition for sabr is that you don't complain. You don't use your mouth to complain to the people, saying, I'm going through this and this. But that you hold it to Allah. إِنَّمَا أَشْكُوا بَثِّي وَحُزْنِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. So, Sheikh, you're in the UK?
Sorry?
You're in the UK?
Yeah, alhamdulillah, I'm in the UK, Manchester.
Manchester, mashallah. How are the Muslim community there? What's your local masjid?
Alhamdulillah, they're good. I'm actually on the outskirts of Manchester, in Oldham. And local masjid is my father's masjid called Ross Street Masjid.
Ross Street Masjid, mashallah, tabarakallah. Yes, Brother Adam, what is your question? The Sheikh is here.
Adam, you can write your question, inshallah. Allah.
It's still alone haram.
Allah. Ask the scholar.
Alhamdulillah. Inshallah, we will stop here then.
Jazakallah.
I mean, we're honored to have you. Inshallah, we have you back again. May Allah bless you. One question, how would we respond to those who say kuffar are happy without tawheed?
Okay, we'll take this. We'll finish with this last question, inshallah. How would you respond to those that say the kuffar are happy with without tawheed? There's a number of things, and I don't want to make it too long. Firstly, when you talk about happiness, we don't talk about temporary happiness. We don't talk about that. That is not happiness. That is, you know, just something temporary, and that, you know, you can that's what haram is, and that's why a lot of people do the haram, because they get that instant temporary happiness. Okay, and as insan, we've been created weak, and we do not have that patience. So we want, when it comes to the jaza or something, we want that straight away. So that's why we look for these haram things. So we get this happiness, but this is temporary happiness. It's not true happiness. And we give the example before. As those who are footballers or celebrities, you know, they have everything, but you'll find they are the ones who are most depressed. And every now and then, you'll find an interview of a singer or whoever it may be. They come out saying that, yeah, I'm not, you know, I'm not that happy. I'm not depression. I've got a counselor that I go to. They mention all these things, and they have everything. And on the outward, it looks like they're happy, but in their heart, a true contentment is not. Whereas, and this, subhanAllah, reminds me of a statement of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. And those that know the life of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, is he went through hardships. And he was thrown into jail, I can't remember how many times, 4 times or whatever it may be. And then what did he say? He said, what can my enemies do to me? Imagine somebody who is being prosecuted and being tortured and being thrown into jail. He is saying, what can my enemies do to me? They want to kill me, I'm a shaheed. They want to exile me, it's hijrah. Okay, they want to do whatever, anything they will do to me, there's an answer to it. I'm content in my heart. He doesn't have money. He doesn't have a family that's going to back him. That doesn't matter. These are all materialistic things. That true contentment is only in the heart. And like we mentioned, and only with the remembrance of Allah can those hearts find a true contentment, that true peace, and that true happiness. And ultimately, if you want the happiness that actually counts, is the happiness which is in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on Yawm al-Qiyamah. So even for argument's sake, which is not the case, but argument's sake, you don't find the happiness in this dunya and the kuffar find it, let them have it. Because the happiness which counts is the happiness which is standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That day when the sun is so close and there's no shade except for the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That day when mothers will run away from their children, brothers will run away from each other. That day when even the anbiya, even the prophets are scared. And then when you come for the accountability in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if you've affirmed that tawheed, that happiness that you gain then, there is nothing like it. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enters you into his al-jannah, There is nothing like it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He grants us this blessing of entering into Jannah, and He makes us from those who enter into Jannah without any hisab and no azab. And we'll stop here, inshaAllah. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
جزاك الله خير أستاذنا الفاضل. يا الله bless you.
آمين. السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.